Hey guys, so I'm back with my iPad, ready to continue pulling what I thought were powerful quotes from this really nonfiction memoir book written by Solomon Northup, who was a slave for 12 years, as the name of the book implies, and let's begin. So we begin this video with chapter 7, and I quote, "Our master's name was William Ford. He resided then in the Great Pine Woods, in the parish of Aboyeles, situated on the right bank of Red River, in the heart of Louisiana. He is now a Baptist preacher." So this is the context of his slave master, William Ford. Next quote. "In many northern minds, perhaps, the idea of a man holding his brother man in servitude and the traffic in human flesh may seem altogether incompatible with their conceptions of a moral or religious life. From descriptions of such men as Birch and Freeman, and others hereinafter mentioned, they are led to despise and execrate the whole class of slaveholders indiscriminately. But I was sometimes a slave, and had an opportunity of learning well his character and disposition. And it is but simple justice to him when I say, in my opinion, there never was a more kind, noble, candid, Christian man than William Ford. The influences and associations that had always surrounded him blinded him to the inherent wrong at the bottom of the system of slavery. He never doubted the moral right of one man holding another in subjection. Looking through the same medium with his fathers before him, he saw things in the same light. Brought up under other circumstances and other influences, his notions would undoubtedly have been different. Nevertheless, he was a model master, walking uprightly, according to the light of his understanding, and fortunate was the slave who came to his possession." So, I really like Solomon Northup's kind of realistic portrayal of even the people who were his slave masters. He doesn't say in this book, like, all people who hold slaves are evil. You know, there are kind, upstanding citizens who happen to be slave masters. But Solomon has a more kind of negative reaction against the system itself and what that entails. You know, here is this man, William Ford, a preacher, who his religious beliefs say, you know, holding any man in subjugation is a wrong thing to do. But he was brought up by his father, his great-grandfather before him. That's, you know, having a black man as a slave is just something that we've always done. It's something natural. So he, because of that, you know, in the circumstances, that's just William Ford. This is what he's always done. And that's why Solomon Northup says here that, you know, maybe if William Ford was born in a different circumstance, he would have, you know, he would have been like a northern guy. You know, people in the north saying slavery is a wrong thing. Who knows? Next quote. "I was now known as Platt, a name given me by Birch, and by which I was designated through the whole period of my servitude. Eliza was sold by the name of Drady." So, being sold into slavery not only means that you lose your freedom, but you lose your birth-given name as well. This was the case with Solomon Northup and his fellow slave person, you know, his friend, Eliza, went by the name Drady. And Solomon went by the name Pratt, which is going to complicate matters, as you'll see way later in the story. Skipping through the next quote. So this is like pages down the road that I have this quote here. "Ford was at that time a wealthy man. Besides his seat in the Pine Woods, he owned a large lumbering establishment on Indian Creek, 4 miles distant, and also in his wife's right, an extensive plantation and many slaves on Bayou Bluff." So just goes to show you, you know, Ford is a rich man. In this time in history, most white people did not have slaves, even in the South. Most people aspired to have slaves, but only rich white people did. Or people, you know, wealthy enough to afford slaves. It was a luxury item to hold in that time. So I just wanted to kind of point out that William Ford was among the rich men who had a plantation, and Solomon Northup was one of his slaves. Quote, "We usually spent our Sabbath at the opening, on which days our master would gather all his slaves about him and read and expound the scriptures. He sought to inculcate in our minds feelings of kindness towards each other, of dependence upon God, setting forth the rewards promised unto those who lead an upright and prayerful life. Seated in the doorway of his house, surrounded by his manservants and his maidservants, who looted earnestly into the good man's face, he spoke of the loving kindness of the Creator, and of the life that is to come. Often did the voice of prayer ascend from his lips to heaven, the only sound that broke the solitude of the place." So William Ford is a preacher, and he's very preachy to his sleeves as well. Next quote. Sam's piety was frequently observed by white men who came to the mill, and the remark it most generally provoked was that a man like Ford, who allowed his slaves to have Bibles, was not to fit to own a nigger. So a lot of other people in the town are angry at William Ford for preaching the word of God to his slaves, because the other people around him don't think that slaves deserve the right to be taught the Bible to them. They're not beings not worthy of that. You know, they're beings lower than that. You know, so I guess Solomon kind of portrays William Ford in a very positive light here, in this story, throughout the story, you know. As he says, he's a kind and upright man, upright preacher. So it's an interesting kind of juxtaposition of a slave master who is a slave master, but not evil and not entirely just totally vicious and cruel, you know, which is what I think we kind of tend to have a picture of a slave master. You know, when we think about it now in the modern age, like, who can have slaves but a person without a conscience or a person so evil, right? Like, that's kind of like, you know, any person who would have the mind to own another human being as a slave in this age, you know, we would kind of maybe see him as an evil person. But in this society, you know, it's not a person who's evil who necessarily has a slave. It's just that was kind of the norm back then. And many different kinds of people ended up being slave masters, even an upright preacher like William Ford. Next quote. It was a source of pleasure to surprise Master Ford with a greater day's work than was required, while under subsequent masters, there was no prompter to extra effort but the overseer's lash. So this also differentiates William Ford from other slave masters in that William Ford praises his slaves for doing great work. The other ones, the only thing they got was threat that they were going to be whipped. If they didn't do as much work as required. People who did great amount of work, whatever, that's what they were expected to do as slaves. Next quote. Mr. Ford loaded me with commendation. On all sides I heard Ford's Platt pronounced the smartest nigger in the Pine Woods. In fact, I was the Fulton of Indian Creek. So, I guess, you know, Solomon has come from a very privileged background. He was a free man for almost more than 30 years. Now he's a slave, so he has all this learning experience, and I think from first two chapters, we learn what kind of a, you know, Solomon Platt was not, like, he was a middle-class citizen in the North. So, of course, being a slave now, like, all his talents, all his education, it would make really good sense that he would end up being, you know, a very smart person compared to all the other slaves that were born and raised that way, pretty much. Next quote. They were obedient to the chief. The word of Kaskala was their law. They were rude but harmless people. Oh, this is talking about the people of Kaskaya, the native people there. They were rude but harmless people and enjoyed their wild mode of life. They had little fancy of the open country, the clear lands and the shores of bayous, but preferred to hide themselves within the shadows of the forest. They worshipped the Great Spirit, loved whiskey, and were happy. I just thought that was a very interesting anecdote, very opinionated and subjective anecdote about the Kaskaya tribe in that area, in the Great Pine Woods. Now we go to chapter 8. This is a quote starting from chapter 8. I was not allowed to be a moment idle, notwithstanding which Tibiates was never satisfied. He was continually cursing and complaining. He never spoke to me a kind word. I was his faithful slave and earned him large wages every day, and yet I went to my cabin nightly, loaded with abuse and stinging epithets. So somewhere along from chapter 7 to chapter 8, Platt or Solomon's slave master kind of changes in a way. So Tibet becomes his kind of primary overseer, and Tibet is not a kind man or. You know, no one in this story is as kind as William Ford. Everyone is pretty vicious slave master or overseer. Next quote. He seemed to be that morning even more morose and disagreeable than usual. So this is talking about Tibet again. He was my master, entitled by law to my flesh and blood, and to exercise over me such a tyrannical control as his mean nature prompted. But there was no law that could prevent me looking upon him with intense contempt. Next quote. My blood was up. It seems to course through my veins like fire. In the frenzy of my madness, I snatched the whip from his hand. He struggled with all his power, swore that I should not live to see another day, and that he would tear out my heart. But his struggles and his threats were like in vain. I could not tell how many times I struck him. Blow after blow fell fast upon his wriggling form. At length he screamed, cried murder, and at last the blasphemous tyrant called on God for mercy. But he who had never shown mercy did not receive it. So this is a moment where Solomon Northup actually reacts and responds to the cruelty he receives upon being whipped for no reason at all, other than Tiobet being drunk. And instead of taking it, like a slave should, Solomon actually responds to it the way a normal human being would, to try to defend himself and whipping it back and, you know, reacting to it. Of course, for Solomon Northup, this is, at the time, this is a very dangerous thing to do. So a slave could be put to death for this kind of action. So let's continue. As I stood there, feelings of unutterable agony overwhelmed me. I was conscious that I had subjected myself to unimaginable punishment. The reaction that followed my extreme ebullition of anger produced the most painful sensation of regret. An unfriended, helpless slave, what could I do? What could I say to justify, in the remotest manner, the heinous act I had committed of resenting a white man's costumely and abuse? That's the heinous act, to resent a white man's abuse, right? And it's punishable by death. This is another quote. It's a very short quote that I pulled out. "Now then," inquired one of Tiobet's companions, "where shall we hang the nigger?" So that's one of the responses of Tiobet, the master, who tried to beat up Solomon for whatever reason. And Solomon responded by taking the whip and whipping him back, which is a heinous crime in this time. Next quote. "Hope died within my heart. Surely my time had come. I should never behold the light of another day, never behold the faces of my children, the sweet anticipation I cherish with such fondness. I should that hour struggle through fearful agonies of death. None would mourn for me. None revenge me. Soon, my form would be moldering in that distant soil, or perhaps be cast to the slimy reptiles that fill the stagnant waters of the bayou." Tears flowed down my cheeks, but they only afforded the subject of insulting comment for my executioners. Powerful stuff. I mean, this book is extremely, extremely powerful. And I'll end it there. Of course, Solomon Northup does not get hung. Otherwise, this book would not have been written. But it's extremely important to note that, you know, Solomon Northup is the type of person who take only so much before he responds. And for any other slave, you know, something like that would be punishable by death. And Solomon Northup, in his story, this happens again later, something like this. But Solomon Northup luckily gets out of it because of his kind of his education, of his talent, because of his connections to other more powerful white people as well, such as William Ford, as you'll come to see later on, unless you've already read this book, in which case, you know, you're here for my, like, reaction and commentary. I don't know what you're here for if you've already read this book, but that more power to you. So that's where I'll stop for today. Next video, we'll begin with some quotes from Chapter 9. Cheers.